Morning.
Butch Ikels, the Country Church, Marion, Texas. A short drive to worship the Lord in a relaxed atmosphere.
Goodness of God. Tell me the story of Jesus. Write on my heart every word. Tell me the story most precious, sweetest that ever was at this Christmas time. Tell how the angels in chorus sang as they welcomed his birth. All glory to God in the highest, peace and good tidings to earth. Tell me the story of Jesus. Write on my heart every word. Tell me the story most precious, sweetest that ever was heard. And in my life, Lord, tonight, be glorified, be glorified in my life, Lord, be glorified today. In our praise, Lord, please be glorified in our praise, Lord, be glorified today. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. Lord, here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. Amen.
Were you all clapping for the song or for me getting up? Oh, okay. Let's go to the Lord in prayer before I get out of hand. Father, we just want to be still right now and praise you for a place to worship. Father, we thank you for that. And regardless of the weather, we come in out of the cold, out of the rain. And Lord, we just thank you for providing for us in so many ways. Father, we thank you for our brother. You raising him up, bringing him back. Lord, we pray that you'd continue to heal him and strengthen him, use him for his honor and glory. Father, for everything that'll be taking place in the next week, Lord, we pray your blessings upon. Father, we pray for our tour through the Holy Land, and Lord, that as people come, that we'd be able to share with them the love of the Lord Jesus. Father, as we have Charlie Sasser's homegoing, his memorial, Father, give us the anointing. Father, let us feel your Holy Spirit and deliver a message that would draw people from this arena, this area of life, to a saving knowledge of the Lord Jesus. Father, be with Kathy, we pray, and Edith, that you'd have your hand on them. Lord, we'd be forever grateful, for we ask it in Jesus' name, and his people said, amen. Amen. Thank you, and you may be seated. Good to have each one of you, and always good to have guests. Do we have anyone here visiting for the first time tonight? Your heater was out, and you wanted a warm place, and you came, so we're glad that you're here tonight. Mike and Renee Swingler have been married for 39 years today. And I read on Facebook, Renee just waxed poetic and romantic, and it got a little thick, and I wanted so bad, and I didn't do it, but I wanted so bad to say, please send a picture of the dog. Because she talked about her kids and her grandkids and her wonderful husband, and all I wanted was a picture of the dog. That's it. But we congratulate you. Pray God's blessing. All right.
All right.
Brother, sing. You've been gone too long.
I'm glad that I can. This is the my favorite parts of the year, Christmas season. And the truth of the fact is that we can be facing a pandemic and facing things we've never thought we would face. But God is still with us. He sent forth his son, born of a virgin, lived a perfect life, died on a cross in our place, was buried and raised 3 days later, ascended to the right hand of the Father, and has sent forth, poured out his spirit upon us. So Emmanuel, the first advent, Emmanuel in the sense of the Holy Spirit in our midst, and the second advent, because one day he's coming again. Emmanuel, God with us. Emmanuel. To the Lord. It's all about you, Jesus, and all this is for you, for your glory and your fame. It's not about me, as if you should do things my way. You alone are God, and I surrender to your ways. Sing that again. It's all about you, Jesus, and all this for your glory and your fame. It's not about me, as if you should do things my way. You alone are God, and I surrender to your ways. And Rusty's going to be preaching about that tonight. So, brother.
I get to take mine off. Na, 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 na. I'm getting in the pulpit awful early. And that bothers me because all that does is give me more time to say something stupid. I make sure, you know. Well, you see, the title is Life Is Not About Us. Well, my life's kind of about me, ain't it? And yours a little about you. But if you have your Bibles, turn over to Luke chapter 1. Luke chapter 1. Am I coming out like I'm supposed to?
Yeah.
Okay. And we'll start at verse 26. Dr. Luke writes and says, in the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God unto a city of Galilee named Nazareth to a virgin espoused to a man whose name was Joseph, of the house of David, and the virgin's name was Mary. And the angel came in unto her and said, Hail, thou that art highly favored, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women. And when she saw him, she was troubled at his saying and cast in her mind what manner of salutation this should be. And the angel said unto her, Fear not, Mary, for thou hast found favor with God. And behold, thou shalt conceive in thy womb and bring forth a son and shalt call his name Jesus. And he shall be great and shall be called the Son of the Highest. And the Lord God shall give unto him the throne of his father David. And he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there shall be no end. Then said Mary unto the angel, How shall this be, seeing I know not a man? And the angel answered and said unto her, The Holy Ghost shall come upon thee, and the power of the Highest shall overshadow thee. Therefore also that holy thing which shall be born of thee shall be called the Son of God. And behold, thy cousin Elizabeth, she hath also conceived a son in her old age, and this is the sixth month with her, who was called barren. For with God nothing shall be impossible. And Mary said, Behold the handmaid of the Lord. Be it unto me according to thy word. And the angel departed from her. Now verse 48, I'm going to tag that there. For he hath regarded the low estate of his handmaiden. For behold, from henceforth all generations shall call me blessed. Father God, in the name of your precious Son, Jesus, help me to convey the truth you want me to share. And open hearts to receive your word. Christmas comes every year, and so we're always in this section of the Bible, and sometimes it's easy to just say, Hey, we've been there before. But Lord, help us to listen and learn a little bit about ourselves tonight. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, I don't know why preaching makes my throat dry, but it does. And I thank God for whoever puts this up here. Don't ever let Mary Lou do it, though. Because it'll have strychnine or something in it. Now I'm in. So I read about a little fifth grade girl that came home from school so excited. She was just dancing up and down and jumping and tapping for her mama to look and notice her. And she told her mother that she had been voted the prettiest girl in her class. Well, she came home the next day even more excited. And her mother said, well, what happened today? She said, I was voted the most popular girl in the school. Well, about a week later, she came in dragging in the door with tears coming down, and she was just totally shattered. Well, her mom said, well, what happened? And she said, well, we had a third contest, and I won. And her mother said, so why are you so sad? And she said, well, they voted me most stuck up. You know, humility is a wonderful gift, but it's hard to learn, isn't it? I mean, we have to be embarrassed into it. All of us think we're better than we really are sometimes. I've been around, yeah, but you've been around those churches where preachers get up and strut around like batting roosters. If I did that, I'd break a hole in here, but it sort of loses, to me, it causes me to lose contact with what they're trying to say. You see, at the end of the day, and at the end of your life, character is going to trump everything. Your character is more important than how good looking you are, or how rich you are, or how famous you are, and how popular you are. And we need to keep reminding ourselves that the mirror doesn't lie. Sometimes when Mirlu's in the bathroom and I want the mirror, I get in front of it and start singing, you're so beautiful. And that way she gets out and leaves me alone. But when you look into the mirror, what do you see? What do you see morally? What do you see ethically? And what do you see spiritually? When you look at yourself in the mirror, you'll realize that if you see good character, then you can be humble about it. Because nothing will take you lower than pride. And nothing will lift you higher than humility will. Now, this is seen in the life of a woman that you've all heard of, and you know her by her first name. We're going to talk about Miss Mary. There are just a little stuff for background here. Did you know that there are 93 women who are quoted in the Bible? 49 of them are named. And together they say 14,056 words. Only 11% of the Bible. I don't know how God got away with that. I'm going to ask him about that when I get to heaven. I'm going to hear from my wife when I get home. Now, no one's going to dispute that there is one woman that stands above all the others. With her character, with her communication. In the Bible, the King James Bible, the word communication means lifestyle. Who she was and what she said. Now, it's not a matter of personal opinion. Scripture itself says that she is the most blessed and the most highly favored by God of all the women in the Bible, and really in all of history. Even today, she is the most universally admired woman by billions of people around the world, and her name is Mary. I'm married to her. Okay? If Jesus is the King of Kings, though, some people want to say that Mary is the Queen of Queens, and I don't buy that. Jesus is King of Kings, and there are no queens, and there are no jacks, and there are no dukes and all that other stuff. Now, what you're going to see is what set Mary apart. What made her the most blessed and most favored was not just that she got to be the mother of the Son of God, but that it was her incredible humility. God's people, listen, God's people had not seen, had not heard from the Lord they worshiped for more than 400 years. For four plus centuries, there's no new revelation. There are no new miracles. And the silence in heaven was deafening. And then to the least likely of people, in the least likely of places, and the least likely of times, God sends an angel to make an announcement that would shake and change this world forever. Now, this angel speaks to a teenage peasant girl. She couldn't even spell her name. Then he spoke to a lowly minimum wage carpenter who had absolutely no claim to fame. Then multiple angels spoke to the shepherds, who were considered to be the lowest on the rung of the social ladder. It's as if God was looking for some people with whom humility was not going to be a problem. Now we see in this little study tonight how time and time again God places a supreme value, God places a supreme value on a sublime virtue called humility. How's that? I had to read it, but I got it out. Now, we enjoy the greatest blessings of life today because of a woman who did not go as high as she could, but got as low as she could. And because she went as low as she could, God brought her higher than any woman ever before or since. Now, I got 3 points this evening. And point number one is this. This is what we're going to try to learn. God looks for the presence of humility in our lives. The story begins in verse 26, where it says, "And in the sixth month the angel Gabriel was sent from God unto a city of Galilee named Nazareth to a virgin, espoused to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David, and the virgin's name was Mary." Now, any Jewish person reading this for the first time would have been astonished. Remember, God hasn't spoken for 400 years. And now he decides to interrupt the world's programming for the most momentous broadcast in history. And where does he do it? Not in Judea, which was the heart of God's work. Not in Rome, which was the capital of the most powerful empire in the world. Not even in Jerusalem, the city which was the apple of his eye. But he announces it in Galilee. Now, I want you to know something. Galilee was the Hickville of Israel. I'm just telling you. Now, I came from Hicktown, Westlake. I don't know how. We had Hicks long before they left Sweden, but we know what it's like to live in a hick town. Galilee was an area known for being on the other side of the tracks. It's where the lower class lived. Jeff Foxworthy would have said, you might be a redneck if you came from Galilee. Now, where in Galilee did this announcement take place? Well, see, 2,000 years ago, if Jeopardy had been on, the question would have been, where did God announce to Mary the birth of Jesus? And of course, everybody would answer, Jerusalem. But no, in all the places, it takes place in Nazareth. Now, the first time you ever hear about Nazareth is right here in Luke's gospel. It is never, it's never referenced in the Old Testament. You won't find it in ancient history books because no one and nothing of importance had ever come out of Nazareth. Scholars have estimated it probably had about 200 people living there. Nazareth was the kind of town you went through, not the one you went to. Have you ever had the experience of going on a road trip and or vacation or something, and you maybe even going cross country, and you pull into one of them little hick towns, and you fill your car up with gas, get you a Slurpee and a corn dog, use the bathroom, wash the bugs off the windshield, and get away as fast as you can, thanking God that you don't live there. That's Nazareth. You would thank God that you weren't from there. Nazareth was the headquarters of a garrison of Roman soldiers. And so there were some pagan temples that had been built there for the worship of the Roman God. And many of the young girls there were known to date and fraternize and have relations with and even marry Roman soldiers to the disgrace of the Jewish people. The slogan there was like Vegas, what happens in Nazareth stays in Nazareth. Nazareth had such a bad reputation that when Nathanael heard that Jesus was from Nazareth, he basically wrote him off. He said, can any good thing come out of Nazareth? Now, why in the world would God make the most momentous announcement in history in a region full of rednecks and a town full of paganism? Because he knew that in that town was a little teenage girl that was humble enough for him to use. Now, we tend to be impressed with the big cities. That's where people congregate. In fact, did you realize that 62% of the population of America live in the major cities of the country that comprise only 3% of the land mass? 3% of the country has 62% of the population. And then the rest of us rednecks got farms and stuff, okay? But God doesn't look in places where we look. God's not looking for celebrities. God's looking for humble people. God also seeks these people of humility. The first time we meet Mary, an angel of God is speaking to her. Contrary to what you see in the movies, Mary was a young girl from the other side of the tracks living in a poverty-stricken region engaged to a lowly carpenter. If you had walked by this young lady before the angel had spoken to her, you wouldn't even have given her a second glance. She is an average young girl, born to a lower class from a peasant's town in a poor region of Israel, engaged to this minimum wage laborer. She's not a movie star. She's not a beauty queen. She's not a rich socialite. Furthermore, Mary was not even a full-grown woman. She is a teenager, barely a teenager. It was not unusual for a girl to be betrothed at age 12 and married by 13. Now, I got to admit, if the law would have allowed it, I'd have married Mary Lou when she was that young. That's when I met her, 13, right? I told her the day I saw her, I was going to marry her. And it took some doing, but I got it done by April the 3rd of 69. Bible scholars say that Mary was probably no older than 14, not even old enough to drive. Here's a nobody girl living in a nothing town in the middle of nowhere and face to face with an angel who wouldn't expect to hear these kind of words. Verse 28, and the angel came in unto her and said, Hail! Thou that art highly favored, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women. Now she's just been told that of all the women in the earth, she enjoys a special favor from God and the special presence of God in her life. Now, you can certainly understand her response in verse 29. And when she saw him, she was troubled at his saying and cast in her mind what matter of salutation this should be. I think Mary was kind of thinking, you talking to me? Are you sure you don't have me confused with somebody else? I read about a guy in high school who wasn't very good looking. Not like me, and he wasn't athletic, he wasn't smart, but he had his eye on the homecoming queen, and he wanted to ask that gal out for a date. He went up to her and said, Teresa, would you go out with me? And she said, absolutely not. He said, but I promise you a great time. She said, I'm not going out with you. And he said, why? Is there somebody else? And she said, there just has to be. Okay. Mary could have understood if she had been a queen or even a princess or come from a wealthy family, but she's neither royal nor rich. She has no fortune. She has no fame. Yet this is what makes the next few verses even more amazing. The angel said unto her, do not be afraid. Mary, you have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. And he shall reign over the house of Jacob forever. And of his kingdom there shall be no end. Listen, it never occurred to her that she would be the mother of God's Son. Mary would have never chosen herself. She can't believe what God has said. We see a great picture here of her humility. Listen, humility is not thinking higher of yourself than you should. It's not thinking higher of yourself as you should. It's really not thinking about yourself at all. Stop and think for a second. Why did God's Son come into this world through a pregnant, unwed teenage girl in a culture that honored virginity and shamed pregnancy outside of marriage? Beyond that, why would Jesus be born not in the comfortable surroundings of a royal palace, but into a feed trough and a goat shed? Not to rich and famous and powerful people, but to people of the lowest socioeconomic class who had suffered the apparent shame of having a child out of wedlock. Why'd he do that? It's because God values humility. God disdains the proud. But he delights in the humble. Isaiah 66 and verse 2 says, to this man will I look, even to him that is poor and of a contrite spirit and trembleth at my word. These are the ones I look on with favor, those who are humble and contrite in spirit. That's Isaiah 66 and verse 2. People who get God's attention are not the haughty, they're the humble. They are not the people who see how high they can stand, but how low they can stop. It's not the people who push to the front of the line, it's the people who willingly go to the back of the line. God seeks people of humility. And if you want to be used by God, seek some humility. Now that's kind of hard sometimes because I grew up in southwest Louisiana, 25 miles from the Texas border. And I had cousins over in Galveston. And anytime we went to Aunt Bess's house, which was a great place to go, but I had to listen to them say, y'all got to come to Texas, God's country in Texas. And I finally heard my daddy, that's where I got this, I heard my dad tell Aunt Bess, listen, the only humble thing in Texas is the humble oil and refinery. And but I guarantee you, I loved going to see Aunt Beth. We went and spent some time after we got married, didn't we? Yeah. We had a good time over there. Well, finally, let's keep on going so you're not here all night. Point three, God works through the power of humility. Now remember, Mary's Jewish. She had been to the synagogue and likely the temple, and she had heard how prophets like Isaiah and Jeremiah and Ezekiel had foretold the coming of the king who would reclaim Israel's throne, a king like no other king. He would be the Messiah. Now she's been told that she is going to give birth not just to a boy, not even to just a king, but a one-of-a-kind king, the king of all kings. Now, ordinarily, you would think that would make your head swell. The mother of God's Son, the promised Messiah. That would puff up any woman with pride. But there's a big problem. Now she's good to go, except she did have one seemingly little question. This is in verse 34 where she says, how shall this be, seeing I know not a man? Literally, the sentence says, how's this going to happen because I'm a virgin? Mary may have been a young peasant girl, but she knew how babies were made. She knew she had never come within a country mile of making a baby with anybody. Now, for those who don't know, Luke was a doctor. And he specifically uses the word virgin, making it plain that she had never had any kind of relations with a man. Now, we've been told why she's going to have a baby, but she hasn't been told how. It's not going to be by magic, but it is going to be a mystery. Luke 1:35, the angel answered and said unto her, the Holy Ghost shall come upon thee, and the power of the highest shall overshadow thee. Therefore also that holy thing which shall be born of thee shall be called the Son of God. Now understand, this is not a medical explanation. It is a spiritual explanation. It's not a natural explanation. It's a supernatural explanation. She is going to conceive this male child in a virgin womb. And he is going to be the heavenly father of, or he is going to be the heavenly child of an earthly mother and a heavenly father. Now, in this world today, not only is a child born out of wedlock no big deal, but I read this and I had to go check some other references, and this is what our, people do the censuses and those kind of stuff. But today, the majority of children born today are born out of wedlock. Now, everyone who knew Mary knew how to read a calendar. And they had gossip and women in them days. People would realize that Mary had gotten pregnant before the wedding. There would only be two logical conclusions. Either they had sex before marriage, or even worse, Mary had been unfaithful to Joseph. Now, if she agrees to bear this son, she knows that she would be forever called unsavory names. And that her children, and particularly Jesus, would be made fun of. And they would forever be second-class citizens within that society. Now, just think about this. Second class in Galilee. In Nazareth, where the bums say, y'all are more bum than me. The women would cross to the other side of the street when they saw her coming. She wouldn't be invited to neighborhood parties. Now, in case you're doubting what I'm saying, on one occasion when Jesus was talking to the Pharisees about who are truly God's children, they snidely remarked, we are not illegitimate children. That's from John chapter 8 and verse 41. Malicious gossip followed Mary all her life. Common sense suggests that Mary knew this was a double-edged sword. Yes, this birth would be a blessing that she would enjoy, but when it would also be a burden she would carry to her grave. Knowing the cost of this birth and the price that she would pay, here's her response. And Mary said, behold, the handmaid of the Lord. Be it unto me according to thy word. And the angel departs from her. Now we see the true greatness of this little girl. The word handmaid refers to the lowest kind of servant. It refers to somebody who would voluntarily sell themselves into slavery. It was the most humble act that a person could perform in that society. It was that statement that made Mary such a great woman. Perhaps the greatest woman that ever lived. I don't know. We'll find out when we get to heaven. But truly speaking, humility is when obeying the word of God and doing the will of God and fulfilling the work of God is more important to you than anything in life, including your own life. Humility means that there is one word that you have to remove from your vocabulary, and that's the word if. The word if means you just put yourself first when you say things like, I will do this if it doesn't inconvenience me. Or I will go to the back of the line if there's something in it for me. Or I will give if I can get what I want first. Humility has no ifs, no ands, no ors, no buts in its vocabulary. Now remember, Mary did become the mother of Jesus, the Messiah, the Son of God. Being the mother of the greatest man who ever lived or ever will live didn't go to her head, though, but it did go to her heart. She never traded on her position. She never asked for a divine mother discount. She never called attention to her role in his birth. She never asked for the spotlight or center stage. She never signed her name, Mary, Mother of God. In fact, her last recorded words in Scripture were simply, whatever he saith unto you, do it. But Mary did make a prediction that came true. When she said, for he hath regarded the lowest state of his handmaiden. For before from henceforth all generations shall call me blessed. Mary did become the most famous woman in history. Today billions of people do rise up and call her blessed because of her humility. By the way, how many of you ladies have Mary in your name? I'm married to the only one in here. Y'all don't, well, this ain't Catholic territory. I'm telling you. Oh, I grew up in South Louisiana, and it's like 90% Catholic. Mary was a nobody who became greater than almost everybody because she simply understood four words. And she not only meant them, she lived them. Life is not about us. Because she went lower, God lifted her higher than she ever imagined could happen. And he can use us in his plans for this world, this church, this community, whatever, if we do the same. We just remember we're nobodies, but God's children. Amen? Father, I pray that while the preacher comes, you would speak to hearts. I'm not trying to trash Catholicism. I'm not trying to be controversial. I just, Lord, want us to understand that the greatest woman in history was great because she was humble. She oozed with humility. And Lord, we all need a dose of it from time to time. We get on our high horses and we begin to think we're somebody. Some of us have people in our society have gotten to the place where they don't even think they need you, Lord. Wake us up and shake us a little bit and draw us to you. And help us to learn humility so that you don't have to teach it to us. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Preacher.
Amen. Would you stand tonight as we sing and we allow our spirit to give over to His Spirit. We yield to what He speaks to us about and make decisions that are pleasing to Him as we sing tonight.
Just as I am,
just like we are,
without one plea, but that Thy blood was shed.
Lord, I'm trusting You.
For me,
I'm believing You. Lord, I'm coming.
I'm coming.
I'm trusting You. This verse
just as
is for
I
you.
I
you know it. God knows it.
But mercy and grace,
will you let Him have His way? Lamb of God, I'm coming.
Of God, I come.
Amen. Thank you, and you may be seated just a moment. Rusty, thank you for the message that the Lord laid on your heart. You know, wasn't there a song out, "You're Nobody Till Somebody Loves You"? Aren't you glad that somebody is the Lord Jesus Christ? And because He loves you, you are somebody. And don't let the devil lie to you, treat you otherwise. Amen? Amen. Phil, do you have any word about us for this weekend? Just be here. Okay, 6:30, you've seen it out on the signs, 6:30 Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. And it's an opportunity for us to reach our community. Thank you. Hope comes tonight. She was a member here, had been off, now comes back to unite with the church here. And if you rejoice with her, let her know it. Amen. Praise the Lord for it. Well, I'm looking forward to reaching our community this weekend. Amen. We've got some things coming up that we're praying through, but we may have an opportunity to reach beyond our city limits and whatever in the whole county. Comal and Guadalupe are not that concerned about the youth, the counties, for our young people. And so our arena is becoming more and more useful for the people. And we have a chance to have the whole county show coming up in January, and just make that a matter of prayer, because we'll have people from all over. So it'll be a real opportunity to witness and testify to people throughout our county. So I praise the Lord for, Dave and I were talking, you know, it's easy to get down about all the things that are afflicting us and, you know, do I get the shot, do I don't get the shot, who my president is going to be, and so on and so forth. But praise the Lord, he's still in control. He's still on his throne, and we praise the Lord for that. Sir? Amen. All right, let's stand as we be dismissed. Thank the Lord, thank Hope for uniting. And Robert, how about you leading us, please, sir?
Our gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for this time. We thank you for this place and for these people who have gathered, not only here, but through live stream. Father, we pray that as we have come together and we have heard your word so clearly spoken, Father, I pray that we would, as children of God, remember that the thing most important you ask of us is to look to you, to remember you in each and every aspect of our life. The first thing that we should do is to respond according to your will and your way. Help us, Father, to be responders and not reactors. Help us, Father, to find a way to become more and more humble in our walk with you, to be more and more the men and women of God that you would have us be. May we go out in the rest of this week and serve you as you call each of us. May we be prepared for this season that is upon us. And remember, Lord, that this time of year is Christmas. It's a time to remember the birth of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Help us, Father, to boldly proclaim that. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.